I've delivered I don't know how many kids. I'll be by to see you later.
Hello, darling.
How you feeling?
Well, not very well. I didn't know they were going to put me in so deep. Well, they gave you the privilege of telling me. Do we have a son or a daughter?
We had a son. Helen, I love you. We can look forward to a long, full life.
I am so happy.
As a doctor, I ought to have the words. All I can say is I'm sorry. In time, we'll be able...
What's wrong?
Our child was stillborn.
Dead? What else? Why did they put me under like that? What time is it? How long was I in there?
A long time.
Why? What else did they do to me?
We almost lost you, Helen.
What else?
It was the only way. We can't have children.
No children. My baby dead.
Hey, we will have children. We'll manage to.
Hey, you look wonderful.
Thank you, darling. You're very gallant. And I might say the same for you.
Now that we've bolstered each other's egos, what do you say we do something about our appetites?
Good. Where to tonight?
This little seafood house Carter was telling you about. That's good food, huh?
When did you see Ross Carter?
Helen, let's not spoil tonight, huh?
The great Ross Carter of the Clinic for Planned Parenthood.
Look, we merely discussed the possibility...
Forget it, Richard. For the last time, I won't live a lie.
I'm not so far away. You have to scream it.
I'll scream all I want.
Helen, why do you keep thinking of adoption as a lie?
Because it is. I wouldn't be its mother.
Every year, thousands of people...
I don't care if a million people lie to themselves. If I can't have a child, I won't have one.
You won't. Your tragedy. Look, he was my son, too. Doesn't that mean anything to you?
It means I'm going to have another drink. We have lots of glasses, Richard.
Thank you.
Yes, we argued. Often.
Well, living next door, my husband and I could hear, of course.
Do you know for a fact that any of these arguments were violent?
Well, I once saw Mrs. Kimble with a very bad bruise on her cheek.
She became intoxicated. Fell against the bureau.
And were you present?
Yes, but I was across the room.
Across the room? And what did you do when she fell?
I picked her up, treated her.
And realized how much you loved her.
I did love her. I never stopped loving her. Just that one hopeless area.
You say you saw a boy in a rowboat.
Yes, sir.
But you don't think he saw you. As a matter of fact, you've heard him sitting right there testify that he didn't see you. And now you claim someone else must have seen you. You swear that you saw him. A man with one arm running from the direction of your house. I call to the attention of this court the previous testimony of Lieutenant Philip Gerard.
Immediately following the homicide and over a period of 10 days thereafter, my office interrogated a total of 83 men of such description.
And what were your findings?
That none of them could possibly have been in the vicinity when the crime took place.
Then, Lieutenant Gerard, with your reputation as one of the most brilliant police officers in the state, you were forced to conclude that there never was a one-armed man.
Objection. Objection.
Sustained. I order that stricken from the record. I must warn you, Mr. Rand, you are familiar with the proceedings of this court, and I expect you to abide by them.
My father lived in Stafford. I went there because he suffered a stroke. He didn't recognize me. Anyway, as I was leaving, I turned the corner and I saw this man running out of a house, with one arm missing. There was another car ahead of me, almost ran him down. I didn't know there'd been a murder. The next morning when the story must have come out, I was in Europe with my wife and son. I'm not making this up.
Richard David Kimble, have you anything to say before I pass sentence upon you?
I'm innocent.
Richard David Kimble, it is the verdict of this court that you shall be removed to the state penitentiary and there held until a date to be determined. And on that date, according to the laws of this sovereign state, execution shall be done unto you. May God have mercy on your soul.
now 6 months a fugitive, this is Richard Kimble with a new identity. And for as long as it is safe, a new name, James Lincoln. He thinks of the day when he might find the man with one arm. But now is now. And this is how it is with him. Another journey, another place. Walk neither too fast nor too slow. Beware the eyes of strangers. Keep moving. The right one, or will it be a mistake? Is this the trap where it will end? Safe for now. Another room. Windows look out and look in. Get busy. Look closely. Be sure of this, they'll never stop looking. He'll never stop. Not Lieutenant Gerard.
Somewhere in here, I'm sure of it.
What about Mexico? He's near enough.
Oh, he'd be the Yankee, someone different.
Gerard, when are you due for a vacation?
I'm not taking my vacation, Captain. Later. I will later. East, south, Midwest. Every report verified.
But by the time you arrive...
One day he'll be there.
Phil, from the very beginning, the arrest, all through the trial, the appeals, and the accident. Why? What is it about Kimble?
I enforce the law. The law pronounced him guilty. I enforce the law.
What are you trying to convince yourself of? I remember his defense. Man with one arm running from the direction of the house. Phil, I'm beginning to think that you believe there was such a man.
No, I did everything I could to find him.
Meaning that he didn't exist or that he escaped? And if he did escape, the law made a mistake.
Captain, whether the law is right or wrong is not my concern. Let others debate and conclude. I obey. But when I begin to question, doubt, I can't permit it. Others found him guilty. Others were about to execute him. I was merely an instrument of the law. And am. And Dr. Kimble must be found.
Ready? A job. What will it be? Make no mistakes. Be ready for the questions and hope there won't be too many.
fast, Lincoln?
I worked in Reno.
Well, you won't have to be fast tonight. But tomorrow is Saturday. Bring your roller skates. Take over. It's all yours. $75 a week. You'll find a vest at the other end of the bar. Is it Jim?
Yeah, Jim's fine.
Cleve Brown. But we won't shake hands because I might fire you tomorrow. The waitress is Evelyn and the lady at the piano is Monica. Introduce yourself.
Jim Lincoln. Well, the boss said to say hello. My name's Jim Lincoln.
My name's Monica. Monica, well. Plays beautifully, doesn't she?
Mm-hmm.
Lovely, too, wouldn't you say? Wouldn't you say she was lovely?
Very.
Well, now, how can you tell? You just glanced at her. You got to look at her, Jim. Hey, Jim. Got some soda. Give her one, too.
She isn't drinking.
Maybe she would if you bought it, huh? I'll pay for it.
Doesn't want a drink.
You have one.
I make it a rule never to drink when I'm working.
That's a real dandy rule. You make that up all by yourself?
Jim. About now, I usually have a so-called meal from our so-called kitchen. You want something?
No, thanks. You know that fella back there?
No, why?
Pretty hard to make trouble.
Jim, for the price of a drink, he can buy an audience. On Monday morning, he'll have to face whatever's bothering him. But this is Friday night.
Hey, what were you saying to him about me?
What makes you think I was talking about you?
I don't like you, Jim. You want to remember that? I don't like you at all. See you again, sweetheart.
Fella? Oh, you tell me if it's none of my business. You know, sometimes he's worshippers.
He does not worship me. Thanks for trying to help.
Meaning it's none of my business.
Meaning it isn't fair to involve you.
One bourbon on the rocks.
Thank you. No, please. No. 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 Please. Please.
Is everything all right, Miss Blaine?
Oh, yes, he's fine.
Good.
That's all right. I'll get my money tomorrow. Good night.
Good night. When I asked you not to call the police, I had a very good reason. That man is my husband. You want to leave now, or you want to stick around and hear the story of my life?
Here.
We live in Phoenix. We lived in Phoenix. About a month ago, I couldn't stand it any longer, so I... Mark and came here and got a job doing the only thing I've ever really been trained for, playing the piano.
But not in a bar. What was it you couldn't stand?
His suspicions. I wouldn't mind it if he had a reason to be jealous, but he was simply insanely suspicious. When we were married, I was considered the luckiest girl in Phoenix. Ed was almost the... His name is Ed. Almost the perfect husband. He was a little jealous then, but I was 18. I was flattered by it. A month after he left for Korea, I found out I was pregnant. I was so happy, I... ran 3 blocks in the rain to mail the letter. When he wrote back, there was just a hint of an accusation. But I answered, pretending not to notice, and he never wrote that way again. When he came home, day by day, he began to grow more and more suspicious and violent. His face changed. He doesn't look like the man I married.
And he won't let you go?
No. After a month of peace, he found me. He walked into the bar and he had a drink and left without saying a word. As you know.
What does he want?
To possess me, to beat me, and to teach my son how evil I am.
And you can't go to the police?
I tried that. He found out and found it very amusing. You see, he owns 250,000 acres of Arizona. He contributes to charity and belongs to all of the proper social organizations. He has even been mentioned as a possible political candidate. When he's not home, he's almost the perfect man.
Well, don't you have any friends or family in another state back east?
He'd find us. Mark, what are you doing out of bed?
I heard you talking.
Well, this is Mr. Lincoln. My son, Mark.
My name's Jim.
You know, you should be in bed. We have a big day tomorrow. Come on, let's go up to bed. I'm sorry he wasn't a little more friendly.
Well, that's, I think he did fine under the circumstances. Look, Monica, I don't know what I can do.
It's enough just to talk to you.
Well, then maybe I can see you tomorrow.
On Saturdays, I usually take Mark to Wonderland. Helps him think of other things.
Well, we'll make it noon at Wonderland. We can all think of other things. I'll see you tomorrow.
Good night.
Now I'm going to talk about you hitting me.
And I won't talk about your hitting a woman.
She's my wife.
That gives you certain rights.
You travel pretty light, don't you? Come into town and get yourself a little room, grab a job. Think about staying long?
I'd like to.
So you can make more trouble.
I didn't make it. I walked into it.
You walked into me, bartender.
Yeah, I've already heard how important you are.
I had that custom made for me. Every bit of it, handmade. Take a look at it. Go on, take it. Look at that workmanship on it. It's loaded. I have to carry a lot of money sometimes, more than safe. And that's not going to do you a bit of good trying to help her, because Monica can go anywhere in this world. She can go anywhere. And I'm going to find her. Sooner or later, I'll be there, see?
For another beating?
As long as she behaves herself. Now, you know what I mean.
Well, stop torturing that woman and child. Get yourself some help. See a psychiatrist.
You just said the wrong thing. You said exactly the wrong thing. And you said it, and I heard it, and there's nothing left for you to do but get out of my sight. About a million miles out.
Not very good at picking rides. I guess that was kid stuff to you, huh?
Well, it was all right.
Probably pretty square about what kids like these days.
What do we do now? Another ride? Something to eat?
Look, Mr. Lincoln, I know you want to talk to my mom. I'd like to go over to the batter-up game.
All right, we'll meet you there. Your son went over to the batter-up game. I hope that's all right.
That's fine.
You know, I used to think I was pretty good with children. I didn't seem to be getting anywhere with him.
It isn't your fault. He's afraid every man might be like his father. Sometimes I think he sensed the truth about Ed before I did.
His father paid me a visit last night. He must have followed us and then waited and then followed me to my hotel. Some in substance of our meeting, he threatened me if I didn't leave town. So here I am.
Oh, Jim, this is going too far. You repay...
All we have to do is find an answer. I've been trying.
He threatened you.
Under the pretext of showing off his custom-made revolver.
Yes, he showed it to me. If he threatened you, why don't you go to the police?
I can't go to the police. If you ask me, I can't tell you why.
No position to ask anything of you. Except your help.
Let's go get your son.
Belted that one, son.
Here you are.
What a marvelous strike that was.
Mom, strike is when you miss.
Yeah, Mom, what's the matter with you? What do you play, Mark, the infield?
Second.
You know, I used to play a little ball. You know, how good I was, my sister pitched. Remember one game, a man came up and he said, what's the score? I said, it's 42 to nothing, but we ain't been up to bat yet.
Here.
Well, that's yours, Mark. You won it.
Kid stuff.
What do we do now?
What I can do and what I'd like to do are two different things, so I guess we'll just have to wait. I don't know what for or how long, but we wait.
What are you talking about?
Kid stuff. Come on, let's get a hot dog.
Thank you.
Sweetheart, that's a pretty tune. I know it. You're working hard, huh, Jim? I don't know as I could stand that. People yelling at me all the time. Plus, I had to put up with some of that when I was in the Army. You ever in the service, Jim?
Here's your drink.
Now, in Korea in combat, they used to have these loudspeakers. He told me all about what was going on back here while we were fighting.
I used to tell you.
You have a nice time out there at Wonderland? I saw you. You looked like you were enjoying yourselves. Three of you made it. Nice looking family.
Well, so I'm not going to pretend to guess what made you this way. Your suspicions about your wife are all wrong.
I got no suspicions. Facts, Jim. Real good drinks. I don't know, maybe it's just because I'm in such a good mood, I wouldn't know the difference.
Don't you ever think of what you're doing to your boy?
Well, let's not spoil everything with a lot of unpleasant talk.
Well, see you, Doctor.
I'm in perfect health. I got no idea how good I do feel, Jim. Well, good night, Jim. Good night, sweetheart.
Oh, these desert winds.
There's our camp.
Lady will leave now, a police officer. See me about a fare, ask for Sergeant Burden. We'd be obliged if you'd get in the automobile, Mr. Lincoln. That is your name, James Lincoln?
Yes. Look, you mind telling me what...
Detective Sergeant Burden. Please get in. Detective Fairfield. He's from Ohio.
Where are you from, Mr. Lincoln?
Rockford. Illinois.
You ever see her?
No, thanks. Could you tell me what this is about?
Is this your first visit to Tucson, Mr. Lincoln?
You like it? I haven't seen much.
But you've liked what you have.
How do you like your job, Lincoln?
Well, he hasn't seen much of it. But he likes what he has, correct?
You know... It's funny.
Something funny?
Well, I guess I mean, strange. An average man, if there is one, is walking home and... Police pick him up for questioning. What's your name? Where'd you come from? Etc. You know he's scared.
Is that right? Well, I never knew that. Did you know that, Fairfield?
Now, why would the average man be scared of the police?
Guilt. I guess there isn't a man in the world who doesn't have something he wants to hide. Even you two.
Now, that remark was not calculated to gain favor with me.
I'm sorry. I guess these questions are just getting me a little nervous. You know, know, Sergeant, you are pushing me around. Gently, but pushing. Put yourself in my place. I'm a stranger in town, no one to vouch for me. No friend who's a lawyer. I can't demand a thing, I just have to sit here and take it.
I wish I could argue with you, but you know you're right. I wouldn't want you to think I was sadistic. Fairfield, do you think we've been unkind?
Maybe so, Sergeant.
Well, some comfort to think we've saved your walk on a chilly evening. To your hotel.
Well, I certainly appreciate it.
Not at all.
Good night, Sergeant.
Good night.
Good night.
Mr. Lincoln.
I honest to goodness don't know what's the matter with us.
Well, that's all right, Sergeant. It's an easy mistake.
Of course. But we want to do the right thing.
We'll see you to your room.
Well, you don't really have to...
Mr. Lincoln, we insist. Fairfield, wouldn't you say that it's about time he unpacked?
Oh, maybe he did. Found he didn't like it here. Now he's getting ready to leave.
Well, I was born here. I'll die here. I like to keep Tucson clean as its air. I welcome visitors. Most of them.
Mr. Lincoln, you usually read every paper?
That's how I found the job.
We've had a complaint against you, Mr. Lincoln.
Complaint?
Mr. Edward Wells, Phoenix, claims you're breaking up his marriage.
His marriage is already broken up. I'm just trying to help his wife and boy. They're afraid of him.
That's not the impression we got from Mr. Wells.
Have you talked to Mrs. Wells?
We're not in the marriage counseling business. Nor are you.
Tell you this, unless that man has helped you, might pay a very high price to find out just how dangerous he really is.
He claims Mr. Wells is dangerous, Fairfield. What have you got there?
Hair dye. You use this stuff?
Yeah. Last month, I saw a little gray. I thought it wouldn't exactly help in finding work.
Does a good job. I don't see a single gray. Maybe worries a lot.
Could be diet. I'd read where a man can get gray from certain foods. Are you eating right, Mr. Lincoln?
I eat what I can afford. I try not to worry.
Leave Tucson tonight.
What's the matter? We cost you a job in a wonderful city. Aren't you going to protest?
I'm too tired.
Get some rest in another town, Mr. Lincoln.
Wait for me.
What did the police want?
He convinced them I was an outsider trying to break up his happy home. Monica, I've got to leave town. But if you and Mark come with me, you might be worse off.
I don't understand.
My picture's in every police station in the country. Right now, they might just be realizing who James Lincoln really is. A convicted murderer.
I don't believe it.
I said convicted. I'm innocent. I'm a doctor, pediatrician. I was a doctor. my wife couldn't have children, she wouldn't adopt them. We argued too much for too long. And then I walked out. I got in the car, I drove, I parked. And just stared at the river. I remember a boy in a rowboat. He didn't see me. After a while, I cooled off and I drove home. About a block from the house, I almost hit a man. A man with one arm. He was running. I found my wife beaten to death.
Who?
I don't know. I had to be unmotivated. A vagrant, a prowler, the police never. It was over 2 years ago. The trial was a nightmare. The neighbors had heard our arguments. My only hope was to find the man with one arm. I was convicted. I sat in prison for 18 months. There were appeals. They were taking me to be executed when the train derailed. Ever since then, I've been running, hoping that someday I'd find the man with one arm and the face I can never forget. I keep running and they keep hunting. One man in particular, Lieutenant Philip Gerard. Sometimes I feel like I've known him all my life. Some nights I can't sleep. I hear his footsteps on the stairs. I see his face outside my door. Gerard.
I don't want him to find you. I'll pack.
David.
Well, how are you, Mr. Wells?
I just want to drop by and say thanks. Now, I hope I'm not being premature, am
I? Not at all. I explained to him how we feel about the honored residents of our state.
How do you take it?
Hotel clerk said he checked out half an hour ago. Probably buying a bus ticket right now.
Well, I wish I could express my gratitude in some way.
We accept no bribery, sir.
I mean that, Sergeant.
Well, sir, the sergeant likes to joke.
Yeah. Well, I best get back to my family.
Oh, Mr. Wells, can we drive you?
Oh, thanks. No, I think I can handle this little thing all by myself. Good night.
Good night, then. I don't know. I think you know this job, and all of a sudden you don't. A woman breaks up a fine home to play a piano in a saloon. Take up with a man she's known only a few hours. I feel sorry for the little boy.
Thank you.
One ticket to San Diego.
Thank you, man.
What time's the next bus leave?
Well, that would depend on where you wanted to go now, wouldn't it?
We don't care. We just want the next bus.
Here are your tickets.
Let's go.
Just now.
Yes, San Diego bus outside.
Lincoln!
I'm glad to see you, Marky. I'm glad you're here. See, this is what your mother is. This is what she did to me when I was in the Army.
I don't believe you, Dad.
You did this.
Monica, if I stay...
They'll find you. And you'll never find him.
Well, you can go home now. It's over.
Everything.
We won't forget. That's all we're left with, remembering. Look, maybe...
Thank you.
Mrs. Wells.
I'm sorry about the circumstances.
Who are you?
Mrs. Wells, where did James Lincoln tell you he was going?
You're Lieutenant Gerard, the Tucson policeman.
They recognized him, unfortunately, after the fact. Well, he told you about me. Excellent. He thinks of me as much as I think of him.
He's innocent.
The law says guilty.
The law isn't perfect. Wherever he is now, he knows I believe him. I always will.
Now 6 months, 2 weeks, and another 1,000 miles a fugitive. This is Richard Kimble, and this is how it is with him.